Back in the age of the Game Boy Advance, a Nintendo game series was kept exclusive to Japan. With a mix of tactical strategy and role-playing, it found a cult following.
What happened to Dorcas?
Despite poor North American advertising, 2003 marked the first international release of Nintendo's now flagship RPG series, Fire Emblem. The game was titled Fire Emblem Rekka No Ken, which means The Blazing Blade. In North America, it was simply titled Fire Emblem. But no matter the name, it is the perfected core of the Fire Emblem series. It has all the key features this series is known for, and allows the story and characters to keep players engrossed throughout the adventure. Rekka No Ken is held as a nostalgic favorite. My name is Kevin, and for Beyond Polygons, this is why Fire Emblem is the best Fire Emblem. What? The GBA Fire Emblem games have easily some of the best visuals on the console. It's the attention to detail and the smearing and stretching of each frame that makes each attack mesmerizing. So the following games did start to move towards 3D animations, and it loses the impact that the 2D sprites had. This is the Myrmidon crit on the GBA. And here's the Myrmidon from Fire Emblem Awakening on the 3DS. It's just not as exciting. And what was that swing all about? Though the one-liners and sound effects add this punch to the action and the characters and the, I guess, production value.
Looks like Teach just got tenure.
The animation itself loses its visual charm. Plus, it doesn't have a good frame rate on the 3DS. Also, all the classes look the same. 3D models don't capture that same dramatic style. So all three GBA games use this specific art style, and it's because of this style that they kind of all deserve the praise of best visuals in the series. Just look at sprite sheets of the attack animations. It is something special that was lost when it went to 3D. The art style is iconic and representative of Fire Emblem. There are videos of just compilations of these sprite animations. It's kind of interesting. And seriously, there are some cool ones. My personal favorite is the warrior, because he turns into a friggin' tornado and then just boom! All of a sudden, it just looks awesome. Also, the berserker's floating axe of weird what? It wasn't until Echoes that the animation started to look more exciting again. And I think Nintendo's noticing that the visuals are a big part of Fire Emblem's appeal, though it is worth noting that the newer games pay a lot more attention to music and the soundtrack, and as the battle swells, it's just a lot more exciting and a lot more thematic in that sense. Whereas on the GBA, the music's a lot more bit crushed and MIDI sounding, but a lot of the music is distinctly memorable. But when it just comes down to visuals, the GBA truly stands above the newer games when it comes to its flashiness and beautifully made animations. But if they can incorporate more of those skills, like in Echoes, oh man, I could dig that. Now, these visuals aren't unique to Rekka No Ken, which is what this whole video is supposed to be about, but it's the connected gameplay that it has that truly sets this game as the standard for the entire series. Now, Fire Emblem as a series has three core components: the permanent death, support conversations, and the chapters. Though the support conversations weren't added till the third game, it's become an integral part of Fire Emblem's success. Like all that friggin' marriage and fates, what's up with that? Every installment in Fire Emblem has either stretched, updated, or otherwise included these three components in a varying amount of ways. Some games have actually been more lenient about the permanent death than in other games, such as having a casual mode, or a resurrection staff, which is kind of cool. Games like Awakening and Fate made the supports a huge focus of the game thanks to the marriage and babies. Awakening, along with Sacred Stones, also added a map screen between chapters to give the players more grinding opportunities. Now, when it comes to Rekka No Ken, it is the unhampered, untampered balance of these key features. It doesn't overload players with excessive features and crazy team planning possibilities. It's just play the game. The permanent death. Here it's just par for the course. If someone dies, well, they're not coming back. The beauty of the permanent death here is that there's just enough allies that maybe you let one or two go.
Boo, you stink!
I'll get back to that. As for the support conversations, it is a bit more primitive compared to the games that came after it, but not everyone can marry anyone. The GBA games only let each character have 5 support conversations per run. And if you want to get an A rank, which is 3 conversations, that's 3 out of those 5. You can't do all the supports with anyone else. And admittedly, it does kind of not explain where the bonuses are, but they are there. And if you study what the whole affinity thing is, it's actually like a lot of brainy stuff if you really want to dig into it. It's actually kind of restrictive, but that actually helps with the replayability of the game. The support log is a completionist's nightmare, but those who do want to replay the game have a little more incentive to use different characters and really explore the benefits that different pairings can bring. And lastly, when it comes to the chapters, well, there's nothing else but chapters. There is nothing in between each level. It is simply you play one after the other, and you can save after each one. There are a few bonus chapters to unlock by fulfilling certain criteria in certain levels, and these chapters serve as a reward for veteran players. Plus, it's how to get the true ending. What's important is the lack of any sort of hub world in between. It may seem lacking, but this, thanks to the permadeath and the support conversations, is where the role-playing side of Fire Emblem melds with the beautifully perfected tactical side of the series. Because there's no overworld map, there's no skirmishes to grind with or shops to revisit. This makes each level a proper chapter of the story. You get the opening preambles, and then you get a little bit of battle preparations, but you can only trade items that you already owned. But because players can't grind or purchase items beforehand, players need to do all housekeeping during the chapters. Got your favorite late game mage to train? Better send her off in a convoy of dudes that can protect her, and she'll pick off anyone with low health. There's also grinding in the arena, but that's a death trap. Unless you know the glitch. Nini's Grace, look it up. There's literally a guidance chapter near the end of the game called Battle Preparations. You get to shop for 5 turns. They just give you that opportunity because it doesn't happen anywhere else in the game unless you're like already done the chapter or something. But chapters like Night of Farewells? There's no time to grind. This is a hard chapter, but there's great items if you take the time to search around. Chapters aren't just about stomping enemies, but also making sure to run around, make sure certain characters talk to each other when they get the chance. You gotta make sure you pick up any characters that you can pick up in the chapter. And on top of all of that, you're still stomping enemies. Don't forget about that. Most chapters are route chapters in this game, which are pretty cool. The added complexity of how you find the guidance chapters, as well as trying to grind up your favorite units and making runs to the shops and making sure the supports you want to get are standing next to each other, the tactics and role-playing become one and the same. It's part of the strategy. There's a long game strategy within each chapter for you planning for later chapters. It's an amazing combination of that. It's what makes a tactical RPG a tactical RPG, which Fire Emblem is, you know, the game that started the genre. It helps that the support conversations being so limited, their conversations are actually a lot more connected to the story. The story of the game is a political drama with dark, evil magics going on beneath the surface. It's actually a summary for every Fire Emblem game. But here, the characters all have their place in their story. It's not just, hey dude, remember me, we're brothers. It's not a backstory. Knights in training from neighboring kingdoms, nomads trying to bring peace to the world, defectors from the enemy lines, all feel involved with the overarching plot that's affecting the entire continent. Supports can range from family friends to people just meeting on the battlefield. But because these support conversations are held within the chapters as opposed to some menu in between chapters, it adds this layer of realism to what they're talking about. And Fire Emblem is all about watching the characters grow throughout the adventure. The relationships that emerge, the good level ups, the bad level ups. Because there aren't a ton of features that can streamline the grinding process, player experience is tied to the story that's being told. This is the core appeal of Fire Emblem. Characters can have an odd knack to miss in clutch situations or get crits when they really didn't have to. Plus, although the support bonuses are kind of convoluted in how they work, it's interesting to see how the stats can really change in combat. On top of each character's role in the story and their support conversations throughout, the player's decisions and the RNG can lead to funny, frustrating, or fantastic outcomes. And it's unique to every playthrough. As I mentioned, Rekka No Ken has just the perfect amount of characters. Unlike Fire Emblem 6, where there's just way too many. It has just enough to make each and every playthrough just a little bit different if players want to experiment with different characters. And if one or two die and they're not the ones that you really wanted to use, you can let them go. But certain favorites, like my boy Matthew, you can't let them go. Each and every playthrough is like a Dungeons & Dragons campaign, but one that's so exciting and varied that it's worth replaying multiple times and trying different things with different characters. They can complete the other supports they still haven't collected, or they can even do challenge runs no different than Nuzlocke's in Pokemon. There's limiting the certain types of units you can use or narrowing it down by the weapons that they use. There's drafts that you can do with friends, which I find is really fun. There's even crazy 0% growth runs where level ups don't grant any stat boosts. So watch YouTuber DonDon151's videos on this challenge mode. It's like every chapter is a puzzle. Do be warned, you kind of have to be a fan of the series. It's really confusing if you haven't seen it before. But Rekka No Ken probably has the most gameplay-friendly story to play through multiple times. First up, there are three separate stories. Lin, which is the 10-chapter tutorial and sort of beginning of the story, and then Hector or Ellie would do the last 20 chapters and get to see the story from a couple of different perspectives. So right there you got at least two playthroughs because you got to do Elliewood and Hector separately. And if you want to get the true ending, you have to do Lin's mode before both of them, so... The guide chapters are one thing to figure out in multiple playthroughs. Some are actually quite hidden, but it's 2018, you can look that stuff up. However, even the regular chapters can have a few variances. Depending on the level of your lords, one chapter can be a bit different, or another chapter that checks if your melee units or mages have the higher combined levels. It's these little things that makes each playthrough different from the last. This also ties back into using different units, and it can actually like affect the chapters you end up getting. Fire Emblem 6 actually does this in a whole bigger fashion, but the problem is that you only play through one story in Fire Emblem 6. It's just Roy's story, and it doesn't really change, and the story's kind of boring, in my opinion. And like, you need to beat it 7 times just to get like the endgame prize. It's weird. There's also just way too many units, so they're all kind of forgettable. And actually, the story takes place after Rekka No Ken. That's right, Rekka No Ken's a prequel. Everyone knows that. Rekka No Ken sets the stage for the basis of Fire Emblem Tales. Political drama plus the dark magic guy was actually the bad guy all along. How didn't we realize this? Taking place on the continent of Alib, it is the tale of murdered kings and the princes and princesses that need to take the reins and prove themselves to get revenge over these corrupt dictators and rebring peace to the continent. But oh no, it turns out that this bad dude Nurgle has been pulling the strings all along, and he's been practicing some crazy dark magics. Also, we gotta protect these two blue-haired kids because for some reason Nurgle's chasing after them. Story actually has a little bit of weight to it, not gonna lie. I feel like what Rekka No Ken does right is drops the whole political drama as soon as possible to get to the real dark magic stuff. Fate's laid on that thing way too long, and even the dark guy was kind of who we figured it would be all along. And Awakening's whole Valm saga was, it's slow. Rekka No Ken has a side plot that brings out more emotional talks between the characters. There's different perspectives of the same story and pretty well-written villains. Also a decent enough plot twist in the later act that actually made me kind of care about the characters a little bit more. There's enough drama and realism in the characters and their supports, and as few as they are in each playthrough, they're all good because of the underlying stories of how all these people banded together. not just everyone trying to get laid. Though some could see it as dated, Rekka No Ken is a fan favorite for not just being the first, but for being the simplest delivery of the series. Though a bad save file can be near impossible to finish, the strictness to the core of Fire Emblem is what has set the standard for the series. To watch allies evolve with the story, take detours to go shopping, spend time with friends and family on the battlefield, and all the fun of sudden crits and misses at the worst times, Rekka No Ken is a masterpiece that struck a chord with the early adopters outside of Japan. It is undoubtedly the perfect foundation of a Fire Emblem game. Not needing the marriage or children or DLC or an overworld or any other qualities of life, Rekka No Ken gets to deliver its story and characters to their fullest. It is undeniably Fire Emblem, and though it could benefit from the streamlining of the features in later games, it is a game that can stand on its own because it is everything that Fire Emblem is all about. Well-designed levels that take patience and planning to get through unscathed, a lack of grinding and shopping opportunities that binds the housekeeping with the tactics, and a straightforward storyline that's actually worth reading into. Heck, I could deal with Fire Emblem 6's story if I had control over the parents. That'd be really sick, actually. Though the marketing was poor and the slashing of the tagline kinda hid that this isn't the first Fire Emblem game, it is unabashedly what a Fire Emblem game is, and is deservedly the best Fire Emblem game, in my opinion. Leave your hate mail down below. Thanks for watching. Hey, thanks for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, be sure to subscribe and hit the like button or the notification bell or whatever else they ask you to do. I've actually been having a fit of playing these tactical RPGs again because I've played so many Fire Emblem games, it's easily one of my favorite series of all time. So if you want to see more Fire Emblem stuff, be sure to check back in and follow me and all of that, whatever it is.